On this episode of Inside Engineering, we talk with project manager Matt Slagel about design build, water resources, his custom signboard, the value of building relationships, and a whole lot more. Plus, catch the bonus content from this episode as we dive deeper into water resources. No pun intended, obviously. Wouldn't do that. Inside Engineering, untold stories and fascinating people from the world of civil engineering. This is episode 13, recorded in October 2019. Design Build and Water Resources with Matt Slagel. Inside Engineering is an RKK podcast. Learn more at rkk.com/podcast. And welcome back to another episode of Inside Engineering. Today with me in the studio is the man, the myth, Matt Slagel. Welcome, Matt. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Tim. I appreciate it. We've been listening to the first couple of them at home with my wife, and she has remarked how good of a podcast voice that you have. So I wanted to at least, send that on to you.
After today, I hope she knows that yours is way better. She'll be able to tell.
Yeah, well, we'll find out.
So thanks for joining us, Matt. Matt is a project manager in our water resources group here at RKK. And as we've talked about in a lot of episodes, I mean, project manager is a sort of industry standard title and doesn't really describe what you actually do,
which
is what you're interested in. But why don't you talk about what you actually do, but also in the context of like your career as a whole, how you've gotten to where you are. I'll give you just take a few minutes and walk us through that.
Well, I've gotten to where I am from a very non-traditional path. I actually went to school for environmental science, started out first job out of college for 2.5 years, not in the engineering world. Had a buddy of mine up in York where I was living at the time. He was bugging me for about a year to come work for them, site development. And sure enough, I went in, interviewed with them. The owner of this small company took a big flyer on me. Of course, I had no experience. I worked my way up and worked my tail off. And, my wife and I moved down to Virginia, and then we moved back and went to grad school for environmental engineering, kind of marry up the environmental science and the engineering side. Lo and behold, after a ton of mentoring through my career, a lot of hard work, I sat down and took the PE 12 years later after I got into this field. And sure enough, got my PE, and here I am at RKK with a lot of opportunity ahead of me.
So you got your PE. What does that let you do that you couldn't do before?
That's a good question. Obviously, to state the obvious, I can sign CO plans at this point. But leading up to, the actual getting of the PE and me being officially able to sign the CO, I was still undertaking that standard of care. I still was responsible for designs. I just couldn't be kind of that forward face with my seal on the plans. I got the PE. It was great. Obviously, it's kind of the bare minimum for what you need in this industry. But the next day, I woke up. I was like, oh, great. I don't have to study. I don't have to do that again. But I just kept rolling. Not a whole lot changed, day one after the PE.
Is there some another certification beyond the PE that you're looking at?
So, it's been about a year and a half now. I went back and got the design build certification, which you can obtain that certification after 3 years of design build experience. That's been very valuable, and it's kind of where a lot of my focus has turned, still from a water resources specific viewpoint, but in the design build world. So that's within the last 3-4 years, that's been one of my major focuses. I didn't even really know what design build was before I came to Arc NK. I got involved in the Maryland 404 project, and it just kind of took off from there. And now I love it. I love that project delivery style.
Okay, so we've talked about design build a little bit
with Jim and Barry,
right? And they talked a little bit about progressive design build,
sure,
and stuff. But why don't you give us a bit of a primer on design build in regards to how you work, the kind of projects you work on, and maybe even walk us through 404 or another, you know, project that sort of fits the role of being maybe a typical project.
Yeah, so you know, I think Barry and Jim covered kind of the difference between standard bid build, the way the industry was for the longest time, and then somewhere around 25-ish years ago, maybe even a little bit before then, design build start come into play. And before, with bid build, you know, the owner, State Highway, for example, has one contract with us as the engineering firm, and we take the design out to 100%. And then they go have another contract with the construction company, and then they go out and build it. And there's, you know, at that point when, you know, the owner acquires the engineering firm up front, they take on a lot of that risk. So when you go if there's errors in the plan, if there's differing site conditions, which, you know, they still can't completely get out of that risk in design build. But in design build, they essentially have one contract, and that's with the contractor design team. And so, you know, there's a lot of risk transfer, and that's one of the biggest benefits of design build to the owner. I like it. We like it because we can cut through some of the challenges that we have during design bid builds and just go. Let's go get this thing done. That's one of the big benefits also to the owner, is speed of delivery. So that is a good lead into Maryland 404. You know, State Highway had put together a set of plans out to 20%, 25%, 30%, put it out to the industry. And one of their major goals, the top goal, was speed, schedule.
And what was the challenge of the 404 that this project was trying to solve with 404? What was the problem?
So the problem was that Maryland 404 previously, as a basically one lane each direction, east to west, was a pretty dangerous road. Huge amounts of traffic in the summertime for folks from, you know, Pennsylvania, Maryland, D.C., traveling to the beaches in Maryland. And a lot of accidents, far too many deaths occurred. So, you know, that was really kind of the biggest or the main genesis of why 404 came to be. It had been planned for a long, long time. And under this new administration, they decided that they wanted to get this thing taken care of. So essentially what it did was it dualized the highway. So median in the middle, and then two lanes, both eastbound, westbound, cut down on the left turns, which is really where the high danger comes into play. When this came out on the street, you know, it's 10 miles long. Two lanes to four lanes, lots of stormwater management, and lots of earth movement. And the primary goal being schedule was you have to deliver this project to most completion. So they didn't have to be fully complete, but needed to be complete such that there weren't any permanent lane closures.
Okay.
In 20 months.
Wow.
So that's design, permit, approval, construction, 10 miles in 20 months.
That seems fast.
Yeah.
And it seems like you agree that that's really fast.
That's incredible.
How long would that take typically outside of a design build or, you know?
Yeah, I was thinking, I knew you were going to ask this question. I was thinking about this last night, and I would think minimum 3 years.
Wow.
To
So that's a lot.
Take design all the way to 100%. Get all the bid docs ready. Get it out on the street.
That's roughly twice as fast is what the whole process.
Yeah, and 3 years
is generous. Might probably, be generous. It could be even more than that. Yeah, wow.
So came out on the street, and everyone's kind of panicking because, you know, we were teamed up with one contractor, and other firms were teamed up with contractors, and you know, the realization hit quickly that this is probably not possible. And if we say we can do this, we're acquiring so much risk that, you know, we're going to have to either figure something else out and team up with people or walk away. And that's what we did. We teamed up, and I wasn't involved in this part of the process, but we teamed up with two other firms and two other construction teams and made one big tri-venture construction and design, and we delivered that thing to substantial completion. Couldn't think of that before. In 20 months. And it was a huge success.
Wow.
You know, a lot of long nights, stressful conditions, but fun. And you look back on it, and it's like, wow, how did we get that done? How did, you know, two other big firms that we generally compete with, how did we just put all that aside and come together as one big team and collaborate, communicate well across teams in fast conditions and get it done? And we did. So that feels good looking back on. That was kind of my big kind of jump into design build. So it was an exciting project for sure.
For sure. Yeah, absolutely. You mentioned the partnering aspect of it. And I think that's one of the more unique things about this industry is that one day you may be competing against another engineering firm.
Exactly.
And then the next day, or even at the same time on different projects,
right.
You are
oftentimes.
Oftentimes, right. You are partnering with them. You are in it together on the same project, working together to accomplish the same goal.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that a little bit? I mean, give us some insight into
definitely
that.
Definitely puts you in a, you know, precarious situation oftentimes. But, you know, it all comes down to, you know, we're all trying to do the same thing. Our clients are all the same people. And, you know, really what we're trying to do is provide good, solid service to our clients. And they are too. And, you know, so if you keep that perspective in mind, and generally you want to be a good person, then it makes that, from my perspective, it's kind of easy. You know, low ego, there's no need to be an egomaniac when it comes to working in teams like that or competing against them. You know, it's we're all doing what we're doing, you know, we're all trying to do the same, accomplish the same goals.
The goal is to make the client happy at
exactly.
the end of the day. Yeah. So you just talked a little bit about how we, you know, serve the client and try to deliver those, especially in design build, those projects more quickly, more effectively. How do you measure the success of what you're doing, both from, you know, there's a project that you're working on, obviously,
right.
but then also the people behind the project. And I mean, I think you probably get into a little bit of mentoring and stuff there. How does that all go?
So, in design build, measuring the success is pretty easy. You either get a lot of phone calls from the contractor that aren't nice phone calls, or you don't.
Or you don't get phone calls at all. And that's
exactly. And that's good.
Okay, that's good.
So, you know, no mechanism to measure the success, but, you know, the project gets done on time. If it gets done on time, we get permits in time from a water resources perspective. You know, maybe MOT can be, out there less time, reduces the danger to the traveling public, delivers a project faster for our owner. Obviously, they're trying to deliver projects as quickly as possible and safely as possible for constituents and you and me, our families. That's really kind of, you know, you drill down deep into it. That's kind of our all of our clients, each of us, one another, all the other taxpaying traveling public. But to kind of talk to your other point and question, mentoring, that's one of the more exciting things that I do on a daily basis. It's a lot of fun. I didn't come into where I'm sitting now from a traditional perspective, like I had talked about before. And it was only because of folks, seeing something inside of me, the ability and mentoring and spending time. And, you know, as they spent time with me, it's spending time away from their family. And I totally recognize that. And it's from a day-to-day perspective now for me, it's really kind of giving back to that. So someone spent the time to mentor me. I feel like it's my duty to spend the time to mentor our folks. And we've got a lot of great folks out there, and it's fun to mentor them because you can see the development almost on a weekly basis. If, going back to 404 and then I-270 design build after that, you know, we've been in the trenches with one another pretty deep on some nights, some, you know, long nights. And you kind of develop that trust. You know what you're going to get. It's consistent. And you recognize that, you know, the way I grow, the way you grow, the way any of us grows is to mentor other folks so they can kind of step up a level, start taking over those tasks, which frees you up to kind of jump up and start doing some other tasks also. So, you know, from a purely selfish perspective, mentoring's so important for the company, for each of us individuals. But, kind of drilling down to like what is great about it, you know, just watching people develop, watching success, watching like little wins on a day-to-day basis, seeing the light bulb click on for somebody.
I was just about to say, yeah. There's the light bulb moment. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's one of those things where, you know, I'm walking by and, our staff out there is going to laugh when they listen to this. I walk
That's
by
the whole idea, yeah, right?
I walk by people's desk and I see grading up on someone's screen, and I stop and I'm like, this doesn't look right. You know, doesn't pass the smell test. You know, what's going on here? And then you can talk about it. And, you know, the first five times or so, it's more of a, this is how you do this, or remember, you know, here's what you need to do, like step-by-step fashion. And then after that, it's like, well, I didn't do that because of this or that, and that, you know, and
right.
That's when
it's
you
now
know.
Intentional. They made that decision because
exactly.
of a process that
so
they
that's,
followed.
Yeah. It's kind of like the phase two of mentoring, you know, like you know that someone has kind of taken to something when they can explain what they've done rather than just kind of listen and take it in. And then when it gets really exciting is when they start to kind of push back a little bit. Defend what they've done, argue a little, you know, in a healthy fashion. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think that's the right way, or that's great. That's when you know that people are not just, they don't just have a mastery of what they're doing. They globally understand. And then if they can start tying it to other aspects of the project, or, you know, hey, there's a big water line here, or there's a sewer line. Like, okay, at that point, you're developing a lot of trust in that person, their capabilities, the fact that they're looking at big picture and not just what we do in water resources. And then you can really start to feel comfortable, which then frees you up to kind of point your direction elsewhere. Maybe then get someone else in, slid underneath of that person, and they can start taking over some of the mentoring from a, you know, day-to-day perspective. That's fun. That's a lot of fun. And we got a ton of development happening in our group. I know in other groups, probably from a day-to-day perspective is probably one of the things that I really enjoy most about coming into the office. Spending time with people. You know, I'm a hard driver. I'm pretty intense. But, you know, when it comes down to it, that day-to-day interaction, we'll break it down, we'll laugh, talk about fantasy football or something like that, you know. Weekends, what's happening with your family. That's the fun part. That is really, really the fun part.
I also feel like you have fun with your signboard.
Yeah.
For those of you that don't know, Matt sort of mentors all of us in the office, in the Baltimore office every day with his changeable signboard. He's got one of those little boards that you can put letters on, and he uses it to put up inspirational phrases. Mm-hmm. He numbers them so that we know we can keep track of which one it is.
We're on number 12 right now.
We're on number 12, yeah. Which is
a grateful heart is a place where miracles happen.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
That's like that should be the title of the episode almost.
Right, there you go.
What's been your favorite one so far of the 12 that you've put up?
Oh, man.
There's been some funny ones.
I should have gone back and looked through all of them. That was bad on my part. I didn't anticipate that question.
Oh, I'm sorry. Man, yeah. Yes, that's my yeah, goal. There you go. Always get you with one. No, but
I don't know that I have favorites. You know, the messages are purposeful. Depends upon what I'm feeling that week or that month. You know, they come from all over the place. They come from some of the tea bags that I buy, like on the back of the actual, the little tag has messages.
Yeah.
One of the 12 came off of a Chinese fortune cookie.
Obviously,
you know,
you had to have at least one.
Yeah, exactly. I do a lot of reading of leadership articles, books, kind of general, even like self-help type stuff. It's all important. I think a lot of leadership is like, you know, the leadership stuff that you can, you know, read up on and kind of teach yourself. But a lot of like just general self-help, how to be a good person. That's a lot of leadership happens right there.
Mm-hmm. And I also feel like within the firm, we sort of have a mantra of getting 1% better every day. This is sort of this way that we think about doing stuff is where each day we're trying to get 1% better that day.
Right.
And over the course of time, that leads to this sort of exponential growth in improvement. And I feel like that's something that you really connect with, that whole idea of constantly improving.
Yeah, I mean, that's how we provide value to our Kinkay, to ourselves, to our families, to our coworkers, basically to every person we touch in life, is just get 1% better at something.
Whatever it is.
Yeah. You don't know, you know, you're going to build knowledge and you never know when it's going to come into play. It doesn't have to be engineering knowledge. It could be anything. And, you know, sometimes someone might be in a situation where they don't know the answer to something in any walk of life, and maybe you've kind of developed that knowledge and you can help somebody out. So I expand upon the 1% better, not just from a purely engineering perspective, but just, you know, from a human perspective.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Matt, what is, we're going to go back in time here.
Yeah.
Back to the beginning of your career, or maybe even slightly before it. What's something you wish you had known earlier on in your career?
Oh, man. Early in my career, I wish I knew that everything's about relationships. You know, we've gone through the training, we've been mentored to handle the engineering part of what we do. And obviously, I think it goes without saying that that is a huge part of what we do on a daily basis and extremely important to be technically sound. But beyond that, you know, you can be very technically sound, but you got to be able to relate with people. You got to be able to kind of, when you get in the trenches in difficult, challenging positions, which we're all going to be in at some point, if you've built those relationships or understand a healthy way to build those relationships during those challenging times, it can get you through a lot of stuff. You develop trust in people. That's hugely important. You know, it's one of the things I think that's kind of the, I wish I would have known that earlier. I would have probably spent more time developing relationships rather than just cranking away on work all the time. So yeah, it's one of those things where, you know, with design build being a big focus of mine now, that especially is about trust and relationships. The whole process is built on trust. And if you're not trusting of partners, it's a recipe for a breakdown. And things are going to go very, very poorly. And it's going to get financial at that point. So you got to have good relationships. You got to have trust. You got to be able to, you know, maybe raise your voice at someone at one point and then break it down the next, you know, minute. Cause it gets stressful, but, if you've built those relationships, you can get through that stuff.
There's a foundation there on that relationship.
Exactly.
That's very solid.
Yeah. You recognize it's not personal.
Right.
You know, because you know who they are. They know who you are. It's just one of those times where, you know, you don't know what's happening in someone's life outside of work.
Right.
You know, they could be stressed because of who knows what.
A million different reasons.
Yeah, yep. Exactly. So, you know, you build those relationships, you know that it's just some blip in time.
Yeah. What is something that we haven't talked about yet? You, my friend, are well prepared for this episode.
That's right.
And I appreciate that. There was one thing I was going to ask about, but first I want to see what you might have.
One of the things I've been interested in a lot lately, I've been bouncing around to a bunch of different offices across our footprint.
Which right now we have 30, I believe.
Oh my goodness, yeah. It's fun. It's a fun time. Exciting. But just probably in the last few months, I've been to Raleigh. I'm heading down there again on Monday. Tampa last week. Fairfax. Deal with a lot of the folks in our West Virginia offices. I haven't been out there yet. But starting to, again, develop those relationships with folks, face-to-face, handshakes, laughter. And the one thing I've been thinking about a lot is, you know, working here in the headquarters and RKNK being around here in the Mid-Atlantic, Baltimore for, 4 years shy of 100, there's a certain feel about what RKNK is and does and is about. And it's, you know, you can be here and have a sense of pride that you're involved in that. And I always, you know, as I try to feel what it's like talking with folks, our other great folks, we got super smart people all over this company, what it feels like to work at RKNK at one of our smaller satellite offices. And does it feel like it feels here? Hopefully. And if not, how do we get to a point where it does feel like it's feels here? So I've been thinking about that a lot lately and how, you know, how you, one, ascertain that, and then two, what can you do to help, you know, open up an office, say in, Tennessee, for example. And, we get folks down there who just haven't, they don't know the history of RKNK. And, how do we bring them up to speed so they can kind of spread that? Because, you know, we're going to be building staff down there. And, you know, what does it mean to work at RKNK? It means a lot. And we want people to feel that all over the place.
Absolutely. That's one of the biggest things that we focus on in communications is making it clear and obvious that everyone at the firm is a part of the family.
Yeah.
That it's almost really that it's not satellite offices.
It's like
everybody's in office. Like, this isn't the headquarters. Yeah, it's a big office, but yeah, we were founded in Baltimore, but it's like this, we're all in this together.
Yep.
It's challenging. I mean, it logistics of that make it tricky. I would love to have, people all the time on the podcast that are from other offices, and we're working on that. You know, we're working on at least getting people able to call in, maybe doing a little road show. Looking forward to a road show at some point. But there's a logistical challenge of it. To do something like this or anything. It's obviously much easier to do it with people that are in the Baltimore office, but for everyone from RKNK out there listening, like, we are absolutely want you to have that feeling of belonging.
Yeah, and it's awesome when traveling like that and meeting the folks, and it just it opens up one of those barriers. It's not just over the phone,
right?
We've been doing it for a long time, but now there's when I'm flying down to Raleigh for is a quarterly work share meeting. Talk about how we're sharing work across offices and kind of closing that gap even more, and spreading out risk essentially across the company. Who's light, who's overloaded, how can we make adjustments and still get work done, and allow people to kind of spread their wings a little bit beyond just their home base.
Right.
Maybe work on some really cool projects that we have across the whole company, and build their experience, build their knowledge. It's kind of one of the big benefits I've seen, recently. I worked on the pursuit of the 95 design build down northeast of Fayetteville, North Carolina. And cool project, big project. We won. So that makes it even cooler.
Yes, it does.
Huge project. You learn things. The way NCDOT does something isn't always the way that, say, Highway does something. And just because we've been locked in one location or the other to doing things the way we've always done them doesn't mean that there's not some other way or tweak that we can make to make things better. So, it's kind of goes to the heart of design build innovation. Don't get locked into doing things the same way. Of course, there is always the mantra, if it's not broke, don't fix it. But
looking for opportunities.
Yeah, exactly.
How do you look for that opportunity to get better, to innovate, to provide a better service
exactly.
to our clients? Yeah, I think that's
right.
That opportunity is always there.
Yeah.
All right. Do you have anything else you want to mention?
I want to mention one more thing that's really awesome. Today, there's a wellness workshop that Merit has put together, and I forget the exact name of it, but it's
How to Be a Better Human?
Yes.
Yeah, with Rachel Druckenmiller. Yeah.
Yeah, awesome.
You're going to that. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Huh? Yeah, and hopefully a lot of my other Water Resources brethren are going. We can all learn something to make us a better human being. Sometimes you have to hear it four times to actually let it sink in. Sometimes you just have to think about it. So it's cool. I don't know. Are there other engineering firms out there doing that?
I don't know, but I know but that I know that we
it's
are.
It's pretty awesome.
These wellness workshops are something that we do on the regular.
Yeah, it's cool.
There's a big. I think the company cares a lot about a wellness, you know, from a
holistic
perspective.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. I'm pretty stoked about it.
Well, that's going to be pretty sweet. I'm gonna try to make it down to that. All right, Matt, we've arrived at the point in the episode where it is time for your
pick of the week.
Dun, 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 dun. You got it.
Yeah.
Pick of the week. So this is where Matt's going to recommend something to us that he thinks we're going to like. I happen to know what it is, so I think this is going to work really well. So take it away, my friend.
All right. So I know everyone's going to like these guys. It's a band I've been listening to for a couple of years now. The Avett Brothers.
The Avett Brothers.
Yeah. Do you know them, Tim?
I do.
Yeah.
Don't make me sing. Shame.
Yeah,
there you go. Loads of shame.
So anyways, my wife and I have gone to 5 of their concerts.
That's
already
impressive.
This
wow.
year.
This year?
This year.
2019. You've seen the Avett Brothers 5 times.
Indeed, I have.
That, wow.
And we got one more.
And you got one more.
Down in Greensboro, North Carolina on New Year's Eve.
Oh,
so
wow.
So you folks listening from Raleigh.
And we have offices in Greensboro and Charlotte.
Yeah,
and
Greensboro, Raleigh. Charlotte, yeah. Raleigh. Going to be looking for some ideas to do down there for a couple of days during around Christmas time. So I'm expecting a few emails or Skypes to give me some ideas here.
All right. Well, this is the track Ain't No Man from their album True Sadness.
There ain't no man can't save me. There ain't no man. How can you not feel this?
I don't know how you could not feel it. I mean, this is the style of the Avett Brothers. They're very much that kind of nice groove. How would you describe them for anyone? I mean, obviously we just played a little bit of the track.
It's funny. They're hard to put in a box. They are essentially a folk rock band.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can imagine a rock band with a banjo.
Yeah, banjo and like a
They got a guy up there with a stand up bass, like head banging.
Yeah, yeah.
On the bass.
This is high stepping. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. I admit I haven't heard this track.
Just came out.
Don't be afraid to sing, man.
Nah, no one wants to hear that.
All right. Well,
these guys are cool. They're going back to like the human element of things.
Mm-hmm.
They're good humans. Judd Apatow put out a HBO documentary about them a couple of years ago. It's called May It Last. Go watch it. Super endearing. Hard to not really dig these guys. After listening to their music and listening to them talk, my gosh, if you go watch them live, the energy that they bring is second to none.
They don't phone it in.
No. Back to back nights, they're cranking away at things. Fun band.
All right. I've been big fans of the Avett Brothers for a long time,
yeah,
so I'm glad to see they have a new album. And thanks for bringing that as your pick. That's
yeah,
a good
of course.
One. And well, next time you come back on the show, you have to tell us about your 6th time. See, although I imagine by then you'll be in, you know, double digits.
Yeah, oh yeah. Oh, well, we're already in double digits. Not in 2019, but
so okay, wait. No, okay, so you've seen them, you're going to have seen them 6 times in 2019. How many times have you seen them total?
It'll be 12 in December this year.
And every time is I assume you go back because they put on a real show.
Incredible, yeah. The first time we saw them, we were on vacation out to Colorado visiting mm-hmm. friends in Fort Collins.
Mm-hmm.
And we were doing some backpacking. And it was actually for my wife and I's 10th anniversary. And you know, our friends were like, hey, we're going to this concert. It's at the Red Rocks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Red Rocks.
Tomorrow
night.
Yeah. And I'm like, okay, who is it? They're like, oh, it's Old Crow Medicine Show, and they're the main act, and the Avett Brothers are opening for them. And I'm like, well, I don't really know who either of these bands are, but it's the Red Rocks, and I've wanted to go see a concert there.
You sort of have to go. Yeah.
So we went, and ever since then, I fell in love with them. It's just hard not to. You got to go see them live.
All right, you convinced me. Now I have to,
just
go look at their tour schedule. Were they just
were,
here? Did I just miss them?
They were just here at UMBC like a month ago. And it was the best
very
one.
Very close to UMBC.
it was the best concert that they ever put on that we've been to.
Really?
Yeah. They rocked it out. 2.5 hours. Just them.
Just them. No opening act.
Yeah. Just cranking away.
All right, everyone. Awesome. For those of you listening and watching right now, you are realizing the state of my misery currently.
Yeah.
I need to get my act together.
All right, we're going to go together.
You and I?
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe my wife, because she's not going to let me go.
I'll bring my wife. Yeah. It'll be a double date.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Wow. This is great. I really, man, this episode turned out better than I thought.
Relationships.
And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we wrap up another episode of Inside Engineering. Matt has tied it all up neatly for us. I think maybe you should just host the show from now on.
No, I don't have the voice, Tim.
Matt, do you have any final parting words for our listeners and viewers?
Yeah, I just want to give a shout out. Happy holidays, everybody.
Absolutely. Thank you all for joining us for another episode of Inside Engineering. We release a new episode every Tuesday, and you can find us on our home at our website at rkk.com/podcast. You can stream every episode on demand. We have a video version and an audio version. You can also subscribe to us on just about any of the podcasting platforms: Apple, Spotify, Google, Stitcher, Spreaker, TuneIn. I always forget them all. I don't even know what those things are. I know. There's a lot of them, but we're there. And the point is that you can subscribe, you can leave us a review. We appreciate your reviews. We've also got a feedback form on our website because we want to know how we're doing and we want to make sure this episode's awesome. I know that how this episode's going to be pretty highly rated, so I feel good about that. But thanks again for watching us, and we'll see you next time on another episode of Inside Engineering.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Oh, that's a good call. That's right.